Hello, I'm Lise Doucette from the BBC World Service. This is The Global Story. Today, the United States has called China its most active and persistent cyber threat. It's warning Beijing could interfere in the 2024 election. Washington has been consumed in a debate over the Chinese-owned app TikTok. Intelligence officials say the danger of Chinese espionage and influence stretches far beyond the realm of social media. How worried should Americans be about Chinese interference in this year's presidential election? Joining us today is my colleague John Sudworth, a BBC North America correspondent based in New York. For 9 years, he was based in China. Welcome, John.
Thank you, Lise. Nice to be here.
Also joining us from New York is McKenna Kelly, senior politics writer for the news website Wired. Good morning, McKenna.
Good to be here.
I know a lot of our Global Story listeners will be TikTok users, but many of them won't be. So remind us, how popular is TikTok? How many people are using it first around the world?
Hundreds of millions of people use TikTok globally. In the United States, about 170 million Americans use it, and it's people of all ages, very young folks. The app has a big reputation for talking to Gen Z and young people, but a recent Pew study actually pointed out that the average TikTok user is about 30 years old. Of course, there's people of all ages on the app.
I was really struck by a Pew Research survey last year that found about one third of US adults under the age of 30 not just use TikTok, they get their news from TikTok. And I think for a lot of us, we still associate it with, you know, dancing dogs and fashion videos, but it's not, is it?
At this point, it's more of a short form YouTube, where you can find just about anything on the app. There's, of course, news content, the dance content you mentioned, but other things as well. Like, I love using the app to find crochet patterns. There's crochet creators on there. Those are some of the people that I follow.
John, what about you? TikTok crochet patterns?
No, I'm not into the TikTok crocheting community. I don't think that is the part of TikTok that the US political establishment is all that concerned about. But, you know, as a journalist here in America, you can't help but be on it.
What is abundantly clear, that and pretty well always divided House of Representatives voted with overwhelming bipartisan support to demand that TikTok's Chinese parent company, ByteDance, either sell TikTok or see it banned in the United States. John, why do you think suddenly TikTok has united the House of Representatives? Is that how big an issue it is?
The whole issue of China is, if you like, a rare space of bipartisanship within a very divided US political landscape. That has shifted very quickly over the past sort of few years or so, you know, from a position where most US administrations, you know, going back, Clinton, Bush, Obama, took a relatively pragmatic view towards China. From the moment of Donald Trump's election, that began to shift, and the whole political spectrum has moved very dramatically.
But McKenna, I was really struck when opposition was expressed to the bill. It was the business community saying, my business is going to go under. I rely on TikTok for my advertising. That would be an election issue.
TikTok's For You page is a very accurate algorithm. And if someone is selling whatever they're selling, t-shirts that have a specific slogan on it, or, I don't know, hand soaps or all kinds of, for me, crochet patterns on the TikTok shop, it's very easy to do. And it's very easy to find your audience on TikTok, the people who want to buy those things. So yeah, there's many, many small businesses, whether it's just someone in their house making little soaps that they want to sell, to even bigger enterprises, like huge makeup companies that sell on TikTok shop as well.
if you do ban TikTok, you make the others already powerful even more powerful. And McKenna, Donald Trump said banning TikTok would make Facebook more powerful. And he's already, at least on the day he spoke, said that Facebook was the enemy of the people. They must be just sitting back and watching this and waiting.
Meta isn't exactly just standing by either. In 2018, I believe it was reported that Facebook was paying a GOP marketing firm called Targeted Victory to plant op-eds in newspapers across the country that made TikTok look really bad. They were part of this series of, if you remember, like pointing out the Tide Pod challenge and all these dangerous challenges that were on TikTok. Facebook was part of spreading a lot of this in local newspapers.
So the bill has been approved by the House of Representatives. Then it goes to the Senate. It could take time there. Then it goes to the president's desk. Then there may be legal challenges. So will there ever be a day where this will actually go through?
The question is not whether you can ban TikTok, but whether you can ban TikTok without undermining your own values of freedom of speech. And there'll be almost certainly room there for TikTok to challenge this on those grounds.
I think a good example is to bring up that Montana, the state of Montana here in the U.S., tried to ban TikTok last year. They passed a bill. It was signed by the governor. And then TikTok and a group of creators sued the state of Montana, saying that it was in violation of the First Amendment. That case hasn't been totally resolved yet, but the argument was valid enough for a federal judge late last year to at least file an injunction so it wouldn't go into place until it is totally resolved in the courts.
Do we actually know what, if anything, the Chinese government is doing when it comes to TikTok?
It's extremely unclear. Last week, I know that the House and Senate were briefed on security threats related to TikTok before that vote that took place. But some people came out of it saying that they felt extremely troubled, and other lawmakers came out of it saying that this wasn't really anything that we hadn't heard before.
Earlier this year, the Office of the Director of National Intelligence released a report calling China, and I quote, the most active and persistent cyber threat to the U.S. government, private sector, and critical infrastructure networks. It warned of Chinese hacking and even more of espionage, and said Beijing wanted to sow doubts about U.S. leadership and undermine democracy. John, do you recognize all of this? Is the threat that big, that serious?
Well, in general terms, I don't think it is a controversial thing to say that China has an interest in undermining U.S. democracy. It says so itself to a large extent. From the chairman of the Communist Party, Xi Jinping, down, they have made it very clear that they see themselves in a sort of existential battle with Western values. And in that context, you know, we've seen, over the past few years, decade or so, right across the full kind of array of tools that the Chinese propaganda machine has at its disposal, efforts to push that message, not only to its own citizens in China, but to take that message to global audiences as well.
You know, as John pointed out, they're only targeting TikTok because it has a Chinese owner, although ByteDance has tried to separate itself from China. Is there ever a discussion? There is a discussion about the tech giants and how they control so much, and it seems not many people are willing or able to do anything about them.
I feel like the Congress has been in this big discussion about data privacy and data security, not just for companies stationed abroad, but even like US-based companies like Meta, Twitter, now X, Instagram, all kinds of different platforms, YouTube, Google. And I think the last time this conversation really heated up around privacy was 2018 and the fallout from Cambridge Analytica with Facebook. And there's a lot of calls to pass data privacy regulation. It was the hottest the topic had ever been, and it had totally fallen out. We still don't have anything similar to the GDPR or any kind of data privacy or security regulation here in the United States. And so a lot of experts and people who are critical of this bill banning TikTok have suggested, well, if you're really, concerned about data security, data privacy, why not go after you know, everyone.
Is it possible that ByteDance could sell?
You know, many people would say this is one of the fundamental flaws of this legislation that is going through Congress. You know, almost all proposed solutions have, you know, serious pitfalls. This is why this is such a difficult and thorny issue. You know, an outright ban, were it essentially to stop TikTok operating, risks undermining US values, as we've discussed, in the eyes of some critics, freedom of speech groups, etc. The idea of forcing a sale is very difficult because, you know, the question of the price tag on a social media platform of this size and reach would mean that the only possible buyers would already be very, very large players. You would have the question of the antitrust legislation. Would you want to hand TikTok to a company like Meta, for example, Microsoft, the sort of people with the sort of money and the sort of expertise that would be needed to take over a company like TikTok? These are very, very difficult questions. And TikTok's own solution, which is essentially to try to reassure lawmakers that it is doing everything it can to separate itself from the Chinese government, as we have seen, has faced its own sort of struggles and pitfalls. These leaks about the kind of ways that, you know, some of these systems appear to be a little bit porous, information being shared on group chats between America and China, you know, an exchange, a sort of pipeline of executives brought from China to America. You know, almost everything TikTok does is, of course, then held up to even greater scrutiny, and people can constantly find ways to criticize, you know, the safeguards it's putting in place. So again, you know, I know it's not great for a podcast in which we're kind of trying to pin down answers and look for, there really are no very easy solutions here, at least no solutions that don't themselves throw up further questions and problems.
The critics will say that TikTok has had a lot of time to prove that it was transparent. It set up what's called the Texas Project, and John alluded to this, that it moved TikTok's user data to servers owned by a US company, Oracle. But I've seen some writing by some of the technology journalists saying that they're just paying lip service to transparency. Is that a fair criticism?
It's such a huge question in tech regulation right now, because a lot of what we talk about and what influences people on these platforms and all this is in a black box. We have no idea what these algorithms do. We have no idea, real insight into where data is. And I think, you know, we've had questions like Senator Elizabeth Warren and others have proposed, you know, creating a new agency in charge of like data and tech and regulating that space. Because right now, even with the agencies that we have, and there isn't a lot of ability to oversee these kinds of questions.
Before we let you go, I think we have to end on a different note. All of our discussion has been on the threats and the risks and the power of technology. But this is also a time where there is a fight back, including at the BBC, where we have something called BBC Verify. Even some of the technology companies have put in preventive measures, whether they're good enough or not. How can people spot, including our listeners to the Global Story, whether or not a post is true, whether they should believe what they're seeing, whether it's TikTok or Meta or BBC or Wired, wherever they get their news?
I think you just need to remain skeptical. These things are moving at a lightning pace. AI has become a major threat in elections. We just recently saw the Joe Biden robocall ahead of the New Hampshire primary that was telling people not to vote, which was wild. So my only advice is really to remain skeptical. And if something is too good or too silly or too strange or too whatever, to really question it and look and see if it can be confirmed by other sources that you trust, like the BBC or Wired.
McKenna Kelly in New York from the news website Wired. John Sudworth, BBC North America correspondent, both of you in New York. Thank you very much for joining us here on The Global Story.